Hi everyone, welcome to our next video in our Gear Talk Tuesday video series where we talk about gear we love to use on stage and in studio with What If Elephants. Today I'll be talking about a really cool vintage microphone, the EV664. But before I get into it, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and allow notifications so you can see more videos just like this, as well as our official music video releases and other content released by the band. Here we go. Welcome back, everyone. I hope you're doing well. Thanks for watching, and thanks for tuning into this next episode. Before I get into the microphone, I'd like to just mention briefly that we've just released a brand new single called Guilty Pleasure, featuring Flareke. You can find that everywhere you stream music. And we've actually just released a brand new music video you can find right here on our YouTube page, so be sure to check that out. Without further ado, I'd like to talk a little bit about this beauty mic, the Electrovoice EV664. This is a public address microphone designed and created in the 1950s and widely available today. You can find them on Kijiji, used everywhere. They definitely don't manufacture this mic anymore. But you might have seen this mic in a few different places. ZZ Top have actually used this microphone to tour for a few years. They did modify it though. They've changed out the capsule to an EV510 capsule. You might have also recognized this. Win Butler from Arcade Fire uses this microphone live, but they've actually gutted the microphone and just put an SM57 inside of it, but it still looks badass. You might recognize it also from some of our videos. We've used this mic in our ETA music video, as well as more recently our Sugar Daddy video, and a lot of people have been asking about it, so I wanted to talk a little about this microphone. Like I mentioned, it was built in the 1950s out of Buchanan, Michigan, and it is built like a tank. This microphone is built out of zinc. It's noticeably heavier than most microphones you might use. And funny enough, it used to be referred to as the Buchanan Hammer. Reason being is that Soundtechs might have used this microphone back in the day to hammer in pegs in front of a bass drum so the bass drum doesn't slide as the drummer's playing, and then turn around and use it as the lead vocal microphone, and it definitely does not affect the sonic quality of the microphone. I've never used this one to hammer anything in myself. It's beautiful and completely unscratched, but it's definitely possible. Okay, so I want to talk about a couple of features on this microphone. This is a single moving coil dynamic microphone that picks up in a cardioid pickup pattern, which essentially means it picks up as a heart shape from the front of it. It comes with two different selectable impedances. It comes as a 150 ohm impedance or a high impedance. The way that you make that change is on the cable itself. This is the original cable it comes with. Oddly enough, it does not have an XLR connector in the bottom of the microphone. It actually has a 4-pin connector. Reason for the 4-pin connector is that that's where you make your modification to make it high impedance or low impedance. And it also has a on and off switch, which is pretty cool, but I very constantly forget that it's off and wonder why my microphone's not working. The microphone also has a very cool feature built into it. This is an ancestor of the famous EV-RE20. If anybody knows the Electrovoice RE20, that's a popular microphone for vocals, toms, kick drum, guitar amps. And the reason that it's an ancestor to this is it's actually got a 3-ported system, 3 holes throughout the microphone that allow for a time-delayed version of what's being picked up in front to get added to the signal. And the resulting effect actually allows for a reduction of proximity effect. If you're unfamiliar with proximity effect, that just basically means as the microphone gets closer or further away from the source, you get an increased bass response in the microphone the closer you get. This microphone does not exhibit that because of the ported system. Same as the RE20, which is pretty cool for using it for vocals. You can get a nice even vocal sound regardless of how close or far away the singer is. And it's actually useful depending on what kind of source you're trying to record with it. It sounds great on a number of different sources. Like I said, on vocals, you can kind of think of this microphone almost as an SM57. Kind of was an SM57 of the 60s and 70s, but just with a little more character. So on vocals, it sounds very cool. It's still got full range, but it does sound a little bit bandpassed and sounds very interesting. It's been used widely on kick drum. Rumor has it that it's been used by the Muscle Shoals studio on kick drum. I've also seen some pictures of Aretha Franklin singing into this microphone in Muscle Shoals. You can use it obviously as a vocal microphone, on guitar cab, on snare drum, so there's a bunch of different places you can use it. And let's check some of those out now. I'll give you a little sample of what this mic sounds like. Okay, so I've got a couple of examples loaded up to show you guys what this mic sounds like. You'll notice first of all that I'm actually using the mic right now. So this is the EV664 on a male voice. I'm not going to be singing. But you get to hear what it sounds like with me speaking into it. So it's pretty nice. Sounds pretty good for a mic from the 1950s. It's amazing that it sounds as good as it does. Just to give you an example of the proximity effect that I was speaking about earlier. So as I mentioned, this microphone does not exhibit the proximity effect due to the porting system in the mic, which means that as I get closer, there will not be an increased bass response. And as I get further away, you will not lose the low frequencies. So just to show you, I will level match this. So when you hear it, it'll be all the same level, but you'll hear tonality. You should hear no tonality difference. So here I'm basically eating the microphone. This is the EV664 right close up. And I'll back it away a little bit more to a reasonable level. And you should be able to hear, or you shouldn't be able to hear, much of a tonality difference due to the fact that it's ported. Just for sake of argument, I've also got a trusty SM58. This is a microphone that everybody's probably fairly familiar with, and at least the sound of it. So for sake of contrast, here is the SM58. Okay, so here I am speaking into an SM58 now. Hopefully I've leveled these to be about the same. So the only difference you should be hearing is the tonality difference. Again, these recordings right now, you're listening to these microphones completely unprocessed, no EQ, no compression, just straight into the mixing board and the sound card and then into the computer. So here I'll show you an example of the proximity effect. Again, I'll level balance these so that you can hear just the tonality difference and not the level difference. So if I'm eating the SM58, here it is. I'm sure you're familiar if you've done a live sound before. You're familiar with this sound or the exact opposite. And here I am. I'll pull the microphone away a little bit. This is more of a reasonable distance. This is the SM58 a little further away. And then just so that we can A-B, I'm actually going to pull up both microphones. I've placed them about the same distance apart. I'm the same distance, I guess, to both microphones here. And we'll be able to A-B, and I'll switch back and forth. So right now, you're listening to my voice on the EV664. Again, completely unprocessed, no EQ, no compression. This is the EV664. And here we have the SM58. So this is the SM58. We'll switch again. EV664. Back to the SM58. Check 1, 2. So obviously you can hear there's a bit of a tonal difference. The EV664 is an interesting microphone. It does have a little more mid-range in it, and you can hear there's actually less low end in the microphone. So it could be an artistic choice for guitar cabs. Could work really well for that, depending on what kind of sound you're going for and what other mics you might be pairing it with. So let's jump in. I'm going to take a listen to, I've got a couple of examples here on the drums. We've used it as a kick microphone. I'm just going to switch back to the my other mic that I have, so I'm not using the 664 anymore. And here we go. All right, I'm back on my AKG 414 now, which is processed in full transparency. So I want to take a listen to what the EV664 sounds like on another source, which is going to be drums. I used it as a kick drum microphone. So this is rumored to have been used by a number of different studios. Most famously, Muscle Shoals allegedly used this on kick drum in a few recordings. And you can kind of hear it with the tone of it and in some of those older recordings. In my opinion, this mic to be used as a kick drum mic serves a couple of purposes. So one would be if you're going for kind of an old school vintage sound, this works great. Like I mentioned, because of the proximity effect, it does have a less low frequency response than a traditional kick microphone. That being said, it might pair very nicely with a sub-kick or with a large diaphragm condenser microphone also on the out. So, you know, if you're using a couple of mics, it could be a great pair for that. Or if you're going for the vintage vibe, get it with this mic. So first I'm going to play you just an example of just the EV664, completely unprocessed. Here it is. Let's take a listen. Pretty cool. So you can hear it doesn't have a whole lot of sub content in there. It's kind of punchy. It's got some nice attack on it. This I did put inside the bass drum. It's about 3-4 inches away from the batter head and pointed right at the beater. So it works well for a kick-in mic. And like I said, paired with a sub kick or with a large diaphragm condenser for a more traditional, more, I guess, more updated sound, it would work great for that, for a more contemporary drum sound. Next, I'm going to show you, I recorded that same beat. It's a groove from The Meters. It's a track called Sissy Strut. If you don't know it, great track. I mic'd the kit with just three mics. I'm going for that old school vintage vibe. So I used a ribbon microphone, Behr Dynamic M160 as the overhead, a mono overhead. I'm using another Electro Voice, another vintage Electro Voice mic, which is the 635 on snare drum. And then this is the 664 inside. This is a recording where everything is completely unprocessed. This is just the mics as they were recorded. Just to give you an example of what that 664 sounds like in context of everything. So here it is. Cool. And great. Finally, I'm going to show you what all of these mics can sound like together with a little processing. This is, again, that same three mic setup. This one, actually, I added in a pair of room mics also, a Line Audio OM1 Omni microphones. They're just in there a little bit, just to give a little bit of space. And this is what it sounds like. I've mixed it to sound a little bit like the vintage, the original recording of Sissy Strut. But here it is, just to give you some context. Cool. Great. So there you have it. That's the Electro Voice 664, a beautiful, great sounding vintage microphone for a number of different uses. Be sure to subscribe to our channel and allow notifications if you want to see more videos just like this we have coming in the future. Also, you can see all of our official music video releases and any other What If Elephants content right here on our channel. Be sure to check out our latest track, Guilty Pleasure, featuring Flara K, which was out last month, as well as the brand new music video, which you can find right here on our channel as well. And thank you so much for tuning in. We will see you next time. Thanks!